Ada, Countess of Lovelace, was born Augusta Ada Byron on December 10, 1815, the only daughter of Anne Isabella Milbank and Lord Byron, the leading British poet of the Victorian age. She grew up as a child of relatively privileged means and was privately and informally educated, for reasons we'll hear more about tonight. And as it turns out, before her early and untimely death at the age of 36, even without a formal education, she made a profound intellectual contribution to what we now see as the field of computing, a contribution so profound that it would intrigue and inspire the likes of Alan Turing a century later. We celebrate Ada Lovelace as a figure in computer history on several levels. She was a creative, if not brilliant, theoretical mathematician who served as muse, provocateur, as you heard, correspondent, and helpmate to the intrepid British mathematician Charles Babbage. She was an insightful, emerging engineer whose professional aptitude was utterly stifled in Victorian England because she was a woman. She was a gifted technical writer, denied the opportunity to publish in scholarly journals under her own name, again, because she was a woman. And she was an impudent maverick who did, in fact, skirt the system by publishing a startling scientific paper anyway. And in Silicon Valley, we love those impudent creative mavericks. How Ada Lovelace came to the notoriety for which we celebrate her tonight is quite a story. It goes briefly like this. In 1840, Charles Babbage gave a series of lectures on his analytical engine in Turin, Italy. 2 years later, in 1842, a then relatively unknown Italian engineer named Luigi Menabrea, who would later become the Prime Minister of Italy, published an account of Babbage's lectures in French in a scholarly journal in Geneva. In early 1843, this article was translated into English by Ada Lovelace, who then added extensive notes that were published at the end of the translated article. The translation and her notes were published in the British journal Scientific Memoirs in October 1843 and were preceded by a short account of Babbage's work. She signed her notes simply AAL for Augusta Ada Lovelace. Now here the Lovelace story gets interesting to those being exposed to it for the first time. There were many notable intellectual achievements in the multiple notes written by Lovelace. The notes themselves were almost 10 times longer than Menabrea's essay. Among them were a note G, which works out a method by which Bernoulli numbers could be generated by Babbage's theoretical analytical engine. Today, that method of working out Bernoulli numbers would be known by another name. It would be called an algorithm, which is, of course, an essential component of modern-day computing. Babbage had already devised, at least in theory, more than 20 explanations of processes that his analytical engine might eventually perform, but none of these was published in this way, and he left no clear description of the way to sequence the operations. Therefore, is it fair to say that the first algorithm and detailed programming description for the generation of Bernoulli numbers was the first computer program ever to be published? And since the initials at the end of that explanation were AAL, was Ada Lovelace the first computer programmer? We will explore these questions and more tonight with a panel of three distinguished experts. Professor Ursula Martin of the University of Oxford, who's not only an expert computer scientist, but in her abundant spare time, found the ability to lead a massive curatorial effort at Oxford's Bodleian Library to curate Ada Lovelace's papers and to unpack and solve many of the wonderful riddles that those papers contain. Betty Toole, author of the Lovelace biography, Ada, Enchantress of Numbers. Betty was one of the first people in the world to dive deeply into the Lovelace archive years ago, and certainly many years before the papers were opened to the extent they now are. And finally, the magnificent Tim Robinson, longtime CHM docent and leader of the team that has meticulously studied and maintained the working construction of Babbage's Difference Engine number 2, which has been on display at CHM since 2008, and I hope you got to see it tonight. Tim is a student of Babbage and Lovelace and lectures on them throughout Silicon Valley. Please join me in welcoming Ursula, Betty, and Tim. Come on up. Hello. Welcome to all of you. What did you think of that opening film?
fabulous.
Pretty good.
Pretty good.
Isn't it fun to hear that read? And Ursula, you get a lot of credit for helping us do that. That was a young actress at Oxford, I believe, who
read
from the actual correspondence.
That's right. That's a student from the Oxford University Drama Society. And when we did our version in Oxford of the display that you see downstairs, we had a lot of fun in getting students reading the letters. We had a lot of fun in having competitions for school kids to come in and write a letter to Ada. We were really finding all kinds of different ways of presenting the material to different audiences.
That's wonderful. Let me give you the first question of the evening, because, as I said, by day you're a professor of computer science, and by night, as it turns out, you're also a pretty fabulous curator. So how did you embark on the Lovelace Project, and what made it attractive to you? We have a slide of Oxford, by the way, in case you haven't seen Oxford.
I'm waiting for the slide of Oxford. So this is a slide of Oxford, and right in the center of Oxford, you have Oxford's Bodleian Library. That's part of Oxford's Bodleian Library. You may think you've not seen the inside of Oxford's Bodleian Library, but actually, if you've seen a Harry Potter movie, that lovely, old-fashioned, dusty library, okay, they did a bit of CGI on it to make it even dustier and quainter. That's part of Oxford's Bodleian Library. It has 12 million books in it. 12 million and eight or so by now, I think, but it just acquired its 12 millionth book. It also has fantastic archives, including the Lovelace Byron archives, which are 460 boxes of papers from the Lovelace and Byron families. And if you've seen the display downstairs, or if you've read anything about Lovelace, you'll know that her parents split up when she was very young. And it's quite a modern tale, this. Her mum kept everything because she wanted to prove, you know, that she was right and dad was wrong. So she kept everything, and everything fetched up in Oxford's Bodleian Library, deposited by Lovelace's great-great-grandson, the Earl of Lytton, who still owns the archive.
Why was it important at Oxford to mark this bicentenary of her birth?
I could. How long a sales pitch do you want for Oxford's computer science department? You know, we can... No. I'll spare you the sales pitch for Oxford's computer science department. I think it was very exciting for us as mathematicians, us as computer scientists. It was important to understand the heritage that we have in the Bodleian. For the Bodleian, it was important to think about reaching out to new audiences, to realize that actually it wasn't just archivists and literary scholars who were interested in this amazing archive, that it was people like you guys, it was high-tech people who were still interested in things that had happened 200 years ago. What was particularly exciting for me, doing this thing for the next slide,
We've actually changed the order of the slides. We're going to talk about De Morgan, right?
Yeah, that's it. Well, I'm doing this thing for the next slide. What was particularly exciting for me was that although the archive has been worked on by a great many people, including Betty here, nobody'd really worked in detail on the parts concerning Lovelace's mathematical education. Now, to do that amazing thing she did, writing a paper like that, you don't do it from cold. You have to have learned a lot of things along the way. And she'd learned a lot of math along the way, studying with a famous mathematician called Augustus De Morgan. I'm still waiting for the next slide.
It'll be up there eventually.
It'll be up there. Great.
There it is.
And there we are. Great. So this guy here with his nose in a book is Augustus De Morgan, a very famous 19th century mathematician. If you've heard of De Morgan's laws, that's him. And Lovelace, in her early 20s, embarked on a correspondence course with Augustus De Morgan. This is a chunk of it. She's working through all sorts of things she needed to understand to write her paper on the difference engine. And all of that is sitting in the Bodleian Library. And I was astonished to find, when I got drawn into this project, that it hadn't really been studied by serious historians of math. You know, people like Betty had drawn people's attention to the fact it was there. But when you start talking to, you know how it is when you talk to any scholar about anything, they say, oh, it's more complicated than that. And I was working with a young fellow called Chris Hollings, who's a lecturer in the history of math in Oxford. And I showed this to him, and he said, just like when you showed it to Eric Roberts, is Eric here? Eric said, it's more complicated than that. Chris said, it's much more complicated than that. And so we had the, you know, as academics, you always like to find something new and undiscovered to do. We had the absolute privilege of working through this material using, you know, these days, you work through this material, you see that she's looking at something on page 205, and Google Books, thank you, sponsors, will immediately lead you to page 205 of whatever it is. You can build a whole network of what she's studying. We had the privilege of working through this material and finding out a great many new things about Lovelace, the mathematics she knew, the things she was reading, her strengths, her weaknesses. And that, for me, has been perhaps the most exciting part. It would have been exciting even if she weren't famous, because you really get the impression of the to and fro of somebody studying very hard, studying difficult material, exchanging letters with De Morgan, who was treating her with enormous respect. He was, I don't know, he was leading her to cutting-edge questions of the day, which is another reason why it's more complicated than that, because it's the historian of math. You know, you get some authors, not Betty, you get some authors who say, she must have been stupid. She didn't understand equals. No, she wasn't stupid at all. Mathematicians of the day were having a big argument about what equals meant. Right. And she was right up there with De Morgan trying to puzzle it out.
I'm going to bring Betty in on this conversation too. But and as I do, I just want to say that your comment about her not being that smart actually had been reflected in a number of other things, one of which you sort of disclosed when you got here and we were opening the exhibition, which was that some of the papers had been placed out of order. And you discovered as part of the curatorial process that by having them be placed out of order in that process, it appeared she really didn't know what she was doing, when in fact, once you discovered that, it was quite a thing.
Well, I'd like to make two comments.
Please.
On that. First of all, I think my reaction to looking at the De Morgan papers was, what do these papers represent? Ada was not paying De Morgan. So she was being tutored by someone who she was not paid, and she felt very guilty about that. So what the literary remains are mainly what she would ask questions of what she didn't know, not what she knew. Mm. So the literary remains often reflect her quote-unquote stupidity. There was one particular letter where, in one biography of Ada, that biographer, Dorothy Stein, said Ada was stupid and didn't understand math because she didn't understand what a functional equation was. Well, people who live in different eras have not necessarily a mindset of the Victorian era. Ada didn't. She described to De Morgan her difficulty in understanding a functional equation. She called it a will-o'-the-wisp, that the minute you try to get hold of a point, there was a wave. And that speaks to the metaphors of modern physics. Mm. And there she was, a 22-year-old woman.
You wrote, by the way, I'm so glad you're here, because there's a Berkeley party going on, which is where you got your PhD, and I was afraid we were going to lose you to the Berkeley party. So thanks for hanging in there. We have the cover of your new, your brilliant Ada, the Enchantress of Numbers, and this is the ebook version, as I understand. Right,
because the paper and the hard are now gone, and I like the ebook better because I do include activities at the end of every chapter, really showing how Ada is meaningful to all of us today. One of the things I spoke at Oxford, and one of the things in her description of that Babbage's engine is Ada, it's the questions we ask which determine the answer. And Ada didn't look at that machine as a reflection of herself, but she saw it instead as a synergy. What are its assets and what are its liabilities? And it's because she asked that question, she could see it as a multi-purpose machine. Mm. She could see it being used for art, for music, for business, and then came what is called the Turing objection. And that is, Ada wrote, this engine cannot originate anything. It only knows what we know how to order it to perform. Well, you can play a lot of semantics with it, and today in artificial intelligence, there are many people who say, well, she didn't have enough knowledge, it really can do everything. But Ada's basic goal, and this came out later when she and Babbage had a big fight, in which he put in a preface before that great article, listing all the bad things the British government had ever done to him. It was a pretty long list. And she came back at him, and she, in essence, said, what I am doing is, what you're doing is for fame and glory. I'm not gonna question that, that's okay. But what I'm doing and what this is all about is for the benefit of mankind. So Ada consistently put everything in a human context, and I think that is really what has grabbed me for 40 years.
From the very beginning.
Yeah.
You actually uncovered, then the title of the book is taken from a piece of correspondence in which she and Babbage are writing to each other.
Well, and that's the Enchantress.
And this is the Babbage letter, right,
okay,
in which he...
Right after this big argument.
Yes.
And Ada writing a 16-page handwritten letter of all of Babbage's sins. I really support you, but you better not put in this preface. And she did win on that. And they did make up. And she invited him to her home near Bristol and Ashley Coombe, and beautiful paths to walk on. And she invited him to come, and he wrote back, forget this world and its multitudinous charlatans, everything but the Enchantress of Numbers.
Everything but the Enchantress of Numbers.
Yeah, which...
That was his phrase.
That was his phrase.
And there's another
letter,
really marvelous letter, in which we celebrate her creativity. I mean, the thing that was so intriguing to me about these papers is these flights of fancy that her imagination would take when she's simply sitting and thinking about things, and then she's carefully writing them all down. It's to your point of, you know, the questions we ask determine the answers we get. And here's one of those examples.
Well, she was brought up far from the maddening crowd. Her mother was worried, because she was Byron's daughter, that she'd be preyed upon or what have you. So she was really essentially a very lonely child, tutored And she had her cat, Puff, that she watched and was very observant about. But just doing sums was not enough for Ada. So, like many people, Ada thought, well, I would like to fly. And then she thought, and very carefully, and it covers about 20 pages of letters, of how she would build a flying machine. And that flying machine, how she'd do research, she'd ask her doctor, she looked at birds to see the proportion of the wing to the body, and then she started putting up ropes in a room where she would make wings out of parchment paper, and then she decided she would use everything. She'd fly over mountains and deliver the mail. And her mother came back from one of her health cures and was very disturbed at what Ada was doing and encouraged Ada to remove the ropes. And Ada said, okay, I'll remove them, but I'm gonna make this machine that will be like a horse powered by steam. And I thought when I read those letters that people, you know, they look at you, did you get an A on that test? Did you get all those things right? But with Ada, she was so creative. She was an innovator. And I thought it was very fitting that Walter used her as his first chapter.
His first chapter in his book, The Innovators, yeah. That's right. Tim, I want to get to you about the Lovelace-Babbage relationship in just a second, but before I do, I want to ask a follow-up question. Ursula, doesn't this dreaming of how you would fly and then these experiments and the ropes and the parchment paper and everything, does that remind you of engineering thinking in any way? Is that the way problems get solved in this imagination?
Well, problems
happens.
Problems, you know, even today, you know, people talk about computational thinking. I know Jeanette Wing has written a beautiful article about computational thinking, and the idea that you need creativity alongside engineering heft, that you need imagination, and it is quite remarkable when you read the papers. I must admit, I started off on this project as a bit of an Ada Lovelace disbeliever. You know, I thought, okay, people keep talking her up to the heavens. She can't possibly be as wonderful as everybody says. And then I realized, wow, you know, because you have such a huge archive touching on so many aspects of her life, you do see an extraordinary mind at work. You know, whether she's talking about solving math problems or flying horses or skating or... I don't know, she is a creative and imaginative person and sometimes a bit hyper and rather extraordinary person. Mm.
And how important then, Tim, when you think about the relationship between Lovelace and Babbage and the way they work together, how important is it, do you think, today, now we understand even more about the Babbage-Lovelace relationship than perhaps we ever have?
Well, most of course, of what we really understand about their close interaction over the analytical engine comes from the correspondence that they held over a, you know, sometimes several times a day, exchanging these letters and so forth. But she did actually get to know Babbage much before that. At one of Babbage's parties, she saw the small fragment that Babbage had made of his first difference engine, the so-called beautiful fragment, the machine that at the time people actually spoke of as the thinking machine, or so it seems. Mary Somerville made that comment. Because it's hard for us to imagine what it was like back then when nobody had seen the mechanization of an algorithm to understand what would be possible by machinery. And she obviously got completely drawn in at that point. And it was also the point at which Babbage's project had stalled to try and actually build the full-size version of that machine. And he was already off thinking about the analytical engine, his next machine, how he could generalize it, how he could get around the restrictions that his first machine had to produce something much more powerful. And there is a gap where I don't know that very much is really known about exactly what their working relationship was. But she must have understood a great deal about the analytical engine from conversations with Babbage before she undertook the translation of that paper. And she translated the paper and then presented it to Babbage. And he said, when he saw that, you know, that's great. Why didn't you write an original paper of your own about it? To which she said, well, that thought hadn't crossed my mind. But that's when she set about writing those notes, expanding upon the original description that Menabre had produced, and really taking flight with her imagination of what the ultimate meaning of this stuff would be. And then although she continued to be friends with Babbage to the end of her life, after that letter that we saw earlier quoted, where she basically offered to be his project manager and he flatly declined her, Babbage carried on with the same blinkers on, thinking about his machines from the purely the arithmetic point of view, apparently unmoved by this great vision that Ada had had. So, you know, there are gaps at either side of that main period of creativity where it would be nice to know more, but it's not clear that we ever will.
Hmm. There's a famous diagram called Plan 25, undertaken by Babbage. Talk a little bit about this.
Well, this is one of Babbage's drawings for his machine, the Analytical Engine. So the chronology was his first machine, he called it the Difference Engine, was a machine which was just designed to tabulate mathematical tables by a process known as the method of finite differences, something that made it particularly attractive to mechanize, a very simple process. Then he worked for a decade or more on this machine he called his Analytical Engine before finally coming back and designing the second Difference Engine, the machine you can see downstairs. Now, this one's called Plan 25. In Babbage's notation, the plan drawings were just that. It's a top view, a plan view, looking down on the top of his machine. And as you look at that drawing, what you have to realize is that every one of the circles you see there represents a whole column of wheels, about 80 wheels deep. So there's vast complexity in this. We can sort of think of this in modern terms as a sort of microarchitecture diagram. It shows you the layout of the machine, all the resources that are available, but it really tells you nothing about the details of how they work or how they would be used to actually solve a problem. So on the left of the picture there, you see the large sort of circular structure. That's what Babbage called the mill. We would call it the CPU. It's where all the actual arithmetic took place. And in the center, that large circle in the center represents a set of wheels, again, a stack of these things, which allowed him to take any of those elements around the outside and connect them together. So it's the bus, right? Any two pieces can be put into engagement with those wheels and data can be transferred around there. And then extending off to the right, and this is just a token representation on this drawing, is the store, the memory. In reality, it would extend way over to that wall over there. Because Babbage at this time was thinking of a machine with approximately 100 variables, a variable being a storage location, and he was working with 40-digit decimal numbers. He never managed to invent floating points, so he had to have a lot of precision in order to handle dynamic range. And he used these terms mill and store. Why did he use those? Well, they were taken from the textile industry, the great driver of the Industrial Revolution at the time. You had your raw materials in the store. You brought them into the mill, work on them, produce some product. It goes back into the store till it's ready for distribution. And that's exactly how this machine worked. In modern terms, this was a three-address machine. So you'd have an operation like multiply. It would go fetch two variables from the store, multiply them together, put the result back. So in some respects, it has a very modern flavor. On the other hand, it's not a stored program machine. That store stores only the data. The programs would have been on punch cards. Now, some people in this audience, I'm sure, are familiar with punch cards from the last century, but that's not the kind of punch cards Babbage was dealing with. He was drawing his inspiration from the Jacquard loom, and punch cards for him would have been something like this, strung together, logically more equivalent to paper tape. Now, these small cards like this might have been what he called his operation cards. They had the instructions, you know, add, multiply, so forth. But there were other cards in the machine to store the variable cards, which were the addresses, and number cards, which allowed literal data to be entered into the machine. And you can see on this drawing token representations of the card readers, two at the top and one at the bottom for the variable cards, the operation cards, and the number cards. So programming this thing would have been very different from our notion of programming. It would have been a nightmare writing a program for this machine and actually getting it right. We distributed across three sets of these cards that all had to be coordinated. And if you were trying to do something like a loop, well, you have to wind the cards back, you know. This. Another thing I think we should keep in mind as we consider this is just how slow this machine would have been if he'd built it. This is a computer that we can recognize as a computer, it has the crucial instructions necessary to make it, you know, Turing complete, as we might say. But it had a two to three second cycle time. Now, we know with our experience of modern computers how every time you get an order of magnitude improvement in performance, you know, there's a qualitative difference in what you can do with these machines. And you have to imagine projecting that backwards several orders of magnitude from where electronic machines started in the 1950s to understand what this machine really might have been like. Now, quite surprisingly, oh, the other thing I should say, plan 25, what does the significance of the 25? Well, this machine was always a work in progress with Babbage. This was the 25th iteration of that layout. Right?
Now, but, we have. I was just going to say, because this was always done theoretically.
This is a wonderful cartoon from Sidney Padua, right?
Sidney Padua, who's the young woman that that Vicky was mentioning earlier. Sidney's written this wonderful book. We sell it in the bookstore, The Thrilling Adventures of Babbage and Lovelace, which is a graphic novel, very well researched and very meticulous, but this is her pictorial representation of how the analytical engine might have looked based on Plan 25.
Right, and when she was doing that book, she was very surprised to find that no one, not Babbage or anyone, had ever produced a graphic, you know, a visual representation of what this machine would have looked like. So we have that plan view, and then we have all the drawings of the individual parts of the machine and so on, but no visualization of what it really would have looked like. So that kind of gives you an impression of the size and scale that the Babbage had in mind for this machine.
So now that you've heard from everyone on the panel, this is a good time for me to say you've got question cards on your chairs. Please, if you have a question for any of them, fill those out. We're going to be collecting those in a bit, and I'll be happy to have you participate. That's the way you participate, and we'd love to get your questions. Let me now go back for a second to say, we heard in that opening film a very affectionate but somewhat skeptical Ada Lovelace saying, I think this guy can do it. It's a pretty complicated thing. I'm only going to get involved if I think he's really committed to it, and I'm going to press him to really make it happen. So Ursula, what do we make of that, and what do we make of their working relationship? What did she do for him, and what did he take from her?
Oh gosh, now you're asking. I think what did she do for him? You have to remember that Babbage himself never published an account of his engines. He published many other things. He wrote a wonderful book on the manufacture of, on how factories worked. He published manual log tables. He published mathematical papers. But he never wrote an account of his engine. If you look in the archives, we have Babbage's archives as well as Lovelace's archives, you find all kinds of things where he started off in a big rounding. He has incredibly messy handwriting, as you saw. Messy handwriting. He starts off the principles of the analytical engine, and you think, oh, this is going to... No. 2 pages later, he's sort of whiffled off onto something else. So the first thing she did was actually write a cogent account of how he was thinking and expressed his ideas much more cogently for a general audience than he was able to do himself. I think that was the main thing that she did for him. You know, you can start digging into it more and say she believed in him. Well, you can go down that route of talking about their relationship if you want. What did Babbage do for her? Well, Babbage took her seriously. Other people took her seriously. De Morgan took her seriously. One of the elements I think that's often forgotten in talking about Lovelace, you know, she had all these disadvantages because she was a woman in mid-19th century Britain when there were certain expectations. But one of the things she had that trumped that a little bit was she was very, very posh. Whoever chose the theme music from Downton Abbey for that, you know, there was a reason, wasn't there, for choosing that. Her uncle was Lord Melbourne, who was Queen Victoria's first prime minister and her sort of confidant. She moved in very grand circles, so she was able to be part of a scientific circle, to engage with people like Babbage, engage with people like De Morgan. But the fact that they took her seriously, I think, meant a great deal to her.
Well, there was a salon society, wasn't there, in
That's
Victorian
right.
England, where quite apart from the academy, anyone could come, men, women of all backgrounds could come and exchange these ideas, and she was taken seriously, wasn't she, as a result of this?
Oh, Well, I thought it was amazing when she was 17 and she wanted to find out about the difference engine. She didn't just ask Babbage. She went to lectures at the Mechanics Institute given by a man named Dionysius Lardner. And this was the Mechanics Institute. It was like, well, there's still a Mechanics Institute in San Francisco. It was like the Computer History Museum where 300 people would go to hear about Babbage's engine. And she wasn't shy about doing anything like that. And I thought that was quite unusual at the time. I do want to follow up about something Tim said about Ada's understanding of the analytical engine. And first questions often structure our thinking. And when she was 17 and she'd go to Babbage's house for dinner with Mary Somerville and her mother stayed at home, like a dutiful daughter, she'd go home at midnight and tell her mother what the conversation was. Well, it was a rainy, like the last few days, night in November, and she went, and Babbage had just been refused funding for his difference engine. And as he wrote in his autobiography, which later, Ursula, he did come through, that he had a new idea. Not only an engine that, quote unquote, could act on its results, that had foresight. Well, she told that to her mother, and her mother said, oh, that Babbage, he has all these ideas. And she said, no, it's a universal idea. Then she got married, had three children, ice skated, what have you. But like Babbage, she loved to play games. And she wrote 4 or 5 years before she did that algorithm. She wrote Babbage a famous letter. It was solitaire, not our solitaire, more like Chinese checkers. But she said, what if you could number every peg? Maybe you could write out a plan to win all the time. So her indexing later in the Bernoulli numbers stemmed from that idea. So,
well, we have a slide of this very famous table of Bernoulli numbers that that she produced. And Tim, I want to just turn to you now for a minute to talk about this, because this it's really quite something. This is the published version, of course, but what do we know about how she worked all this out?
Well, this table, as you see here, appeared in note G, the most famous of the notes, where she's working through algorithms for computing this set of numbers, the so-called Bernoulli numbers. There are many different algorithms that could have been chosen. Babbage himself had done a number of examples like this and used a similar format to express them that he'd shown in Turin. But what she did with this one was structure it in such a way that it really showed off the power of the analytical engine, what it could do, because this was something that required iteration, going around nested loops and so on in order to produce these numbers. So the table itself, you can't really call this a program. This is more an execution trace of the program running. So what it actually shows us is what's the state of the variables in this machine at every step in the calculation. And each step would be some operation like add, multiply, or whatever. And you can see those called out in a column on the left. And then over on the right are all the columns in the store where it's actually showing us what's the mathematical expression that's currently represented by the number. Obviously, the only things held in those store locations were actual numbers, but she has written in here the algebraic expressions that the mathematician would recognize as the formula for the number at that particular stage in the calculation. So this was by far the most sophisticated of the examples that were included in the notes and in Menabrea's original paper. And this is the one that that she originated and made that choice. There's no evidence here that Babbage told her exactly what to do. She did correspond with Babbage and said she needed the inputs, the information about these numbers and so on, so that she could do this. But she worked through various possible algorithms to choose this one to illustrate it. Now, it's also interesting, of course, that, you know, like any good computer program, this contains the first bug. There's at least one typo in here that wasn't caught. But it's not surprising. It must have been quite a challenge in the time to get this typeset and proofread and get it into print without even more errors having crept in. There is one notational feature that, to Betty's point here, that Ada introduced. Although Babbage had used something like this, when a mathematician speaks of a variable, they really mean something that doesn't change, right? You know, it can potentially have any value, but once you decide what value it has, it doesn't change. Whereas the variables in Babbage Analytical Engine were like locations in a memory, and their values change every time you compute something new and store it there. So locations in the machine store were being reused in this example. And so in order to make it a little closer to the mathematics, she added an extra index on these variables, which kept track of the, you know, this is the first time this variable's used, this is the second time it's been used, and so on. So each of those independently, the symbols that she's using there, behave like the mathematical variables rather than like the machine's storage location. So she was really thinking through those kind of issues of, is, you know, how we really should represent this. Now, she actually used a feature in this program, or in this example, which the analytical engine, as it stood at the time, that plan 25 and the machine you saw there, a feature it didn't have. Because one thing that Babbage hadn't got in his machine at that time was anything that we would recognize as indirect addressing or index registers. So it was not possible to construct even the simplest data structure on this machine. You couldn't even have an array, right? The only way you could access a location in the store was by having punched it ahead of time on one of the cards. And in this particular algorithm, the way Ada structured it, she wanted it to go around a loop, and each time around the loop, it had to reference the next variable. And she puts in this note very discreetly, well, there is at least a straightforward formula here. We're just adding one each time, you know, kind of implying, well, this is a trivial problem for Mr. Babbage to go off and solve. And you can see in the archive notebooks, Babbage struggling with this particular problem. And there's correspondence between them where she's explaining that she's done this, but I think I handled it very politically. You know, it's just discreetly mentioned in there. There's a little issue.
So she's the product manager directing the engineering staff to go off and get this done. Right.
And she's quite confident that he'll have no problem solving this issue, and they will move on. And,
Ursula, when you were going through these papers, did you look specifically for things like that? Were these little nuggets buried in there that you could run across and suddenly you'd have this aha moment?
Yeah, I found it. It was my first foray into this kind of research, and yeah, I think I read them in that sort of way. I got ticked off by my friends at the Bodleian because I sort of referred to the Bodleian archive as a box of chocolates. You know, you never know what. And they, you know, professional archivists, most Kirsten, don't really like that kind of approach. So I was looking for that, but I was also sort of immersing myself in just, you know, trying to immerse myself in the period and immerse myself in the way that they spoke. So sometimes you find a nugget, and we've got a slide later on of my favorite nugget, but sometimes it was more just the wash of everyday life and the kinds of things they were thinking about and just the details of life that you know. So as I said, they were rather a grand family. Ada Lovelace had three children who seemed to have been, you know, quite demanding and running around and jumping on the furniture and so on, but they also had several houses. So when she wanted to work away at her mathematics, well, what she'd do? She just packed the kids off to one of the other houses with the governess. And, you know, things like that, the rhythm of life for somebody like Lovelace, I found fascinating too.
So I'm gonna get to some audience questions in a second, but I want to ask the question that actually isn't asked here that I thought we would all want to talk about, which is, based on everything we've talked about and you've seen, was she the first programmer?
Well, my opinion is no, and for two reasons. Firstly, because the thing around which all the excitement is based is that note G and the table that we saw there. And as we saw, it was just a table of the execution trace. There is some assumed program, but the program itself would have been, you know, holes in punch cards. And that didn't exist. And if you wanted to take that, to say that table really, well, let's call it a program, Well, Babbage had created some like that before he went to Turin in 1837 and 1838. So then we'd have to give that moniker to Babbage. And that's not what we want here, because, you know, it was her vision of how this thing could be. It was so general, and it could go beyond just merely processing numbers. It's so important. So I don't really like to use the term programmer.
Programmer. Betty.
Well, I beg to differ, because first of all, by asking who was the first one who discovered America, or who was the first programmer, what to me is important is not identifying this was the first. No, we can argue on the head of the pin that Babbage had previous programs. To me, programming is much broader than a table of instructions. And in my mind, Ada understood perfectly clearly what programming was about and what a computing machine was about. And she, when she was 17, saw it was universal. She saw what it could and could not do. And as a result of that, I think her broad vision is more of a vision that we need today, when many people are worried about the impact of artificial intelligence. So I believe that Ada really firmly belongs at the beginning of computer history.
Hmm. Wonderful. Ursula.
I think I agree with both of you.
So you've got the prerogative of doing that as the third one.
Yeah, I think we had a very interesting discussion about this at the symposium in Oxford, because it was a great symposium, as Vicky pointed out, because we had a very multidisciplinary team of presenters, from the people who really understood the detailed technicalities of Babbage's engine right through to historians and professional biographers. And it sort of depended on the discipline which people came from, what point of view they took, on this. And so some of the professional biographers said, well, you know, we're very serious and careful about what we do. If she wasn't the first programmer, we don't want to call her the first programmer. And other people said, well, look, she's been landed with that label. Let's roll with it, and you know, we're not too bothered. I mean, I think Tim's explanation is the accurate technical one. The table that we saw is an execution trace. In modern terminology, the program would have been a pile of these things, but as Tim pointed out, they hadn't quite worked out the technical details of some of those things. And I don't think if you look at the famous paper, the notion of an algorithm, the notion of a program is implicit, but it's not quite explicit in that way. But that points to many other things about the famous paper that actually we haven't really had. We've had deep dives into particular aspects of it, like the table and the possible typos in the table and the possible architecture of the machine. We haven't had a comprehensive multidisciplinary account of it. And, you know, you get the literary scholars going at it and looking at it and saying, hey, what about Coleridge? I go, well, I'm a math professor. What about Coleridge? You know, there's a very rounded picture to be painted of the cultural place of the paper, which would then pick up on the kind of things Betty's talking about.
All right, let's get to a couple of audience questions. There's a quote on the exhibit that mentions her interest in understanding the brain and building machines based on those principles. Did she ever work on this? Is there any record in any of the papers that she actually worked on this? Was this another one of her...
She proposed to Faraday that she wanted to do experiments. And when in her 30s, actually, she was a very sick woman from her teenage years, but in her 30s, she was very ill. And she said, there should be a calculus of the nervous system, that I will use my sick body as an experiment to explain. That's about as far as she got. Faraday, evidently Faraday did not accept her offer to help do this.
Other thoughts on that?
That's the most that I've ever seen.
Yes, she thought, she was very mesmerized. She wasn't just interested in Babbage's computer. She was interested in many of the broad scientific trends of the day, including mesmerism.
Right.
And she thought quite a bit about mesmerism. She read up on, you know, how you might do experiments. She was also in the age of the beginnings of empirical science. She thought about how you might do experiments, how you might monitor the effects of all the different awful drugs that she was taking for her different illnesses. I don't think that there's anything preserved of the work that she might have done, if she did any. There are these speculative writings, which are, it is quite extraordinary when you read that thing downstairs, you know, a calculus of the nervous system. Well, I mean, you know, today we can understand what that, you know, we interpret that phrase in a particular way, but for somebody to be writing it at that time is rather striking. But we're not aware of any more concrete work that she did.
Were there other aristocratic women in scientific, technical, or mathematical communities that she knew or that were in her circle? You mentioned Mary Somerville.
Mary Somerville was obviously a significant one, right?
And college at Oxford named for Mary.
And Ada, to some extent, was following that same trajectory, starting out by translating someone else's work, writing commentary on someone else's work. That's how Mary Somerville got into the position where she was respected in scientific circles. And Ada was following that same path to some extent.
Why would Mary Somerville have achieved such notoriety and success, let's say, where Ada Lovelace did not? Is there a particular reason?
Well, I think Mary Somerville she was an incredibly human, kind, wonderful woman. She never stepped on anyone's toes. She translated Laplace, and as De Morgan, when he evaluated Ada's capability, said she would be a first wrangler because Ada went for conceptual understanding. Mary Somerville, in essence, translated works and which were used at Cambridge and Oxford. But I think it was more her unassuming manner. She was, whereas Ada was not, I mean, some people thought she was quite arrogant. And
interesting.
We must also remember, of course, Ada's life was tragically cut short.
Yes.
And she was very ill in the later part of her life. So while she might have blossomed into more than she was able to do, we'll never know.
It's amazing that while she wrote those notes, which really went from Babbage wrote February. No, those notes cover 2 to 3 months that she wrote that paper. And while she wrote it, she was hemorrhaging.
Wow.
Wow.
Wow. What do the papers say about her social life, apart from her work in this area? What do we know about Lovelace, the young woman, then the life she lived in that period?
Busy, energetic, parties.
Oh.
You know, there was a...
Going to the races.
Going to the races. Yeah, going to...
Balls.
Going to the Queen's Ball. She had an energetic and lively social life. As she got older, I think she became friendly with a number of scientists, not just Babbage, but Wheatstone, Faraday, she became friendly with various. There was a scientist called John Cross who was very interested in mesmerism. She became very friendly with that family. So she combined her scientific interests and her social life. She was often at her mum's beck and call. And she often complained to the editors, oh, I haven't had a minute to sit down and have a quiet moment to myself, you know, as one does.
And we know that Byron left Anne Milbank and Ada shortly after she was born. And did they ever reconnect at any point before she died?
Well, what the strategy was, which I thought was really strange, that Lady Byron accused Augusta and Lord Byron of having a child, Medora, which I personally feel was unbelievable, but the way Byron heard about Ada is through Augusta, through his half-sister. So Lady Byron would tell Augusta that Ada was studying her sums or she was doing this or that, and Byron would get that letter in Italy or Greece and he would reply. And of course, in Byron's biographies, his last words, according to his valet, "Oh, my daughter, if I had only seen her." So there was a lot going on in that family.
Yeah, yeah, a lot of drama.
Oh.
Better than Downton Abbey.
Or Marin County. I mean, well, one of the reasons it had incest, drug addiction, gambling. I mean, it has all of those.
Sort of like a presidential campaign. There's one last question from the audience, and then we're going to go through and answer a delightful question, which is, what were your favorite documents from the collection? But before we do that, has anyone ever executed her note G? Has anyone ever tried to take that algorithm and actually make it work?
Yes. John Walker, one of the founders of Autodesk, produced a simulator to run that stuff many years ago. It's on the web. You can find it out there. He had to fill in a lot of the blanks of exactly how the machine would have done various things, so it's not necessarily particularly accurate. One of the interesting things that happened as a result of the bicentenary and all the preparations for that is that people really started to look at that example in great detail. And I think at the Heinz Nixdorf Museum, they wanted, as part of their celebration, to have some sort of little simulator that you could play around with. And so there was a study done there, and that's where it became apparent, you know, not only how many typos there are in there and other little things that are wrong with it, but also, you know, we have to answer these questions about exactly how did the machine do various things and stuff that, had never actually been worked through up to that point. It was quite surprising that nobody had really got it to that level of saying, okay, we actually want to execute this thing, therefore we have to have everything absolutely precise in order to make that work. We know how stupid computers are, right, if you make any little tiny mistake. So that has all happened actually very, very recently. And there's a paper which will be forthcoming shortly that might explain that.
Does John still have the website for
yes,
me left? Okay, if anybody wants to actually read what Ada wrote, all they have to do is go to Forming Lab.
Forming Lab.
Yeah.
FORMILAB.CH.
Okay.
Google it.
Yeah. Great. All right. So let's go to this this final question, which is the favorite or the most fascinating archival document that you've located. Betty, let's start with yours. This is the paper in which that wonderful phrase appears. Why don't you take this?
Okay. When I was getting my doctorate at Berkeley, and I was doing a chapter on the history of calculating machines, and that was 1976, so now it's 40 years, I went to the Science Museum in London, and I saw this beautiful portrait of Ada, and I saw the analytical engine, and I thought, what is this beautiful woman doing next to this machine? And I went over and read the description, and it said, Augusta Ada Byron, Lady Lovelace, Lord Byron's daughter wrote a description of the first computer. Well, I sort of forgot it until Stuart Brand, who did the Whole Earth catalog, was coming out with this software catalog, and he lives across the water from me, and I took that chapter because in it I had Pascal says such and such, Leibniz says such and such, and the editor said, her. I want to know more about her. I then moved to England, actually, in 84. And for 3 years, I sat with those 450 boxes, and they are totally addicting. And it was a year and a half into my research that I went into a box, and Merritt Clappinson doesn't like it, the curator, when I say it, that was, okay, you've got it at home. You've got a pile of papers on your desk. You have not filed them. You put them in a box. And that was the box I went into. And in the box, I found a scrap, and this was a scrap of on blue paper. And what it was Lady Byron, after Ada wrote the notes, was always pressuring Ada, when are you gonna write something else? When are you gonna do something more? And Ada wrote, "You will not concede me philosophical poetry, inverse it. Why can't you, in essence, give me poetical science?" And to me, that encapsulated what this whole story was about. It wasn't just about math or an engine, but it was about engines and imagination and how great mathematicians and scientists incorporate those two things.
Poetical science.
Poetical science.
That's a wonderful, wonderful phrase. That's great. Tim.
Well, most of the Babbage archive is in the London Science Museum, and there's an incredible amount of information there. 5,000 pages or more of Babbage's notebooks, hundreds of sheets of drawing, and an enormous amount of this mechanical notation, which only now are we starting to fully decode. But the particular thing I put up here actually is from a collection in Oxford. There's a whole bunch of material there that Babbage put together, actually pulled it together sometime in the 1850s to give to his good friend, Harry Buxton, who he wanted to write a memoir about this and a history of the analytical engine. Now, Buxton did get a manuscript for that together, but he never published it. It was only published in, I think it was something like 89 by the Charles Babbage Institute in their reprint series. But this particular page, and unfortunately in this slide here, the facing page has been chopped off, but there was a date up there that, this is, at the bottom, a list of operations. It is the instruction set of an analytical engine. And this is the earliest such list that we're aware of. We know that this predates, we can't quite trust that date that was up there, that was something like October 1834, because there's other things on these pages. But the list at the bottom there certainly is before the middle of 1835, because by June 1835, Babbage already had hardware division in his machine, and there is no division instruction on this list. But what's critical here are items 5 and 6. Those are the two instructions that really make this into a computer: ascertaining if a variable is zero, or ascertaining if a sign is positive or negative. Those are the crucial conditional operations that allow this machine to make decisions based on whatever it's calculated. The rest, we don't really care too much what the instructions are. We know these things are all equivalent, but there's an absolute piece that's essential to make this thing into really in a computer. And there we see it as early 1835. So we have this essentially Turing complete machine in 1835.
Nice. Ursula.
Right, well, my favorite object is something I found going through the archives. I'm sorry, I have to stand up for this because I just have to go into...
Okay, go for it.
So, what is this? Well, you've seen quite a few samples of Babbage's handwriting, and there's Babbage's handwriting over there with these sort of very distinctive curly D's. You've seen some samples of Lovelace's writing, and some of Lovelace's writing sideways. But of course, when I saw this, being a kind of computing geek, I saw this and thought, wow, I know what that is. Now, how many of you know what that is? Yeah, well, somebody in the front row knows what it is. Anyone? Hands up, who knows what it is?
Königsberg.
Königsberg. Yeah, isn't that amazing? So this is Lovelace and Babbage doodling on a table napkin, right? It's a sheet torn out of one of Babbage's scribbling books. And, but of course, you'd love to look at this and think, here they are discovering something new about Königsberg. Well, you look into the context, and no, they're not really there. They're doodling, they're talking by the candlelight. And Königsberg, for those of you who don't know it, what have you got? You've got a river with some islands in it, like Paris, and a bunch of bridges. And what you want to be able to do is to walk around, set off walking, cross each bridge exactly once, and get back to where you started. And if you look at this down here, that's what's happening. The bridges have been drawn in very, very smudgy ink. Babbage was kind of incredibly careless with his handwriting. That's Babbage. And then somebody in pencil is tracing out the path, and you can sort of see how the pencil has smudged through the ink. It's, they're doing it, you know, right there and then. And over there, they're talking about, you know, that's the condition for the bridges of Königsberg. There's lots else going on here. This, well, you're all smart people. You can read sideways, right? What's that? It's a magic square, 294753. And that thing, over sort of behind Tim's head, what's this? Well, they're kind of doodling around with an algorithm for writing down magic squares.
Right.
You know, when you play with magic squares, there are various versions of the algorithm for writing down magic squares. There's something going up vertically there with Pythagoras in it. They're just doodling. They're chatting. We have no idea of the date of this, but then, of course, there's the other stuff we don't understand. You know, that stuff, bottom left-hand corner. Don't you want to believe they're talking about an algorithm for something? But for what? Who knows? I don't know. Anyway.
Tic-tac-toe machine.
Tic-tac-toe machine, maybe.
That's what Babbage wanted to build.
Well, it could be a tic-tac-toe machine. It could be solitaire. It could be who knows what. Anyway, that's my favorite.
Write down some algorithms for that.
Right.
I think that's an incredibly poignant piece of paper because all that imagination and creativity eventually has led us to be able to do something really magical, which is to tweet a hashtag that says CHM Live, which is on the slide. And aren't we grateful for that?
Very good.
I don't know about that, but we are very grateful for our panelists tonight, Ursula Martin, Tim Robinson, Betty Toole. Thank you so much, and thank you for being here.